I'm Laura Coates, and welcome to the first installment of our special four-part series focusing on four of the most crucial testimonies from the trial of former President Donald Trump. Each episode, we're going to take you inside the courtroom to experience the most compelling moments of the trial and explain their possible impact on the case. For those of you catching up, this case focuses on the payments made to Stormy Daniels. It's what's commonly known as hush money. You pay somebody to keep them from telling their story publicly. But hush money isn't illegal in and of itself. Donald Trump faces 34 counts of falsifying business records in the first degree related to the 34 checks, vouchers, and invoices used to allegedly cover those payments up. And the most critical part of that prosecutor's case is that they must allege and have alleged that those payments and their cover-up aim to keep that information from the American public and thereby influence the 2016 election. Now, there are no recording devices or cameras allowed in this court during witness testimony. And only a small number of journalists and members of the public were even able to be inside of the courtroom to witness this historic trial of a former president. So, in this series, we will be experimenting with a new way to bring viewers at home into that experience and show you what happened in that courtroom. We'll display the exact words of the on-the-record transcript provided by the court from each critical day of the proceedings. And using artificial intelligence provided by an independent company, we will vocalize those words. The AI will be reading the court reporter's transcript neutrally. It will not match the voice, tone, or delivery the speaker used in court. This neutral reading will not reflect the specific emotions or tone of the words, much like lawyers and at times witnesses who read from the transcript of testimony in court. And the reader is not intended to be a mimic. Tonight, we will focus on the testimony of the former publisher of the National Enquirer, David Pecker, who testified about his relationship and longtime friendship with Donald Trump, and how they worked out a plan where he would buy the rights to stories that could be harmful to Donald Trump with the intent of never publishing them. In this first portion of his testimony pulled directly from the transcript, David Pecker describes a meeting at Trump Tower with Donald Trump, Michael Cohen, and Hope Hicks, where he agreed to be, as he put it, the eyes and ears of the Trump 2016 campaign.
Directing your attention to a couple of months later, now in August of 2015, did there come a time when you attended a meeting in Trump Tower?
Yes.
Do you remember when roughly that meeting was in August?
It was the middle of August.
And who was present for that meeting?
Donald Trump, Michael Cohen, and Hope Hicks.
And was Hope Hicks there the whole time, or was she in and out?
She was in and out.
How about Michael Cohen and Donald Trump? Were they there for the duration of the meeting?
Yes.
How did the meeting come about? How did you know to go?
I received a call from Michael Cohen telling me that the boss wanted to see me. And that's how. When I spoke to Michael Cohen, that's how he would refer to Donald Trump as the boss.
What did you understand the purpose of the meeting to be before you actually got there?
Most of the time when I received a call from Michael Cohen, he wanted something. So I assumed that they were going to ask. I was going to be asked for something. I didn't know what it was before I got there.
Well, can you describe for the jury what happened at that meeting, please?
At that meeting, Donald Trump and Michael, they asked me what can I do and what my magazines could do to help the campaign. So thinking about it, as I did previously, I said what I would do is run or publish positive stories about Mr. Trump, and I would publish negative stories about his opponents. And I said that I would also be the eyes and ears of your... I said I would be your eyes and ears because I know that the Trump organization had a very small staff. And then I said that anything that I hear in the marketplace, if I hear anything negative about yourself, or if I hear anything about women selling stories, I would notify Michael Cohen, as I did over the last several years. I would notify Michael Cohen, and then he would be able to have them kill in another magazine, or have them not be published, or somebody would have to purchase them.
Purchase the negative stories about Mr. Trump so that they would not get published, you mean?
That they would not get published, yes.
So, I want to break that down a little bit. First of all, when you offered... withdrawn. So, you offered to publish positive stories about Mr. Trump?
Yes.
To publish negative stories about his opponents?
Yes.
And to alert him through Michael Cohen when you came across damaging information, particularly regarding women?
Yes.
And the idea was that so Mr. Trump and Mr. Cohen could prevent that information from being publicized.
Yes.
So you mentioned women in particular. What made you... Are you the one who raised that? Did somebody else raise that? Can you explain to the jury how the topic of women in particular came up?
Well, in a presidential campaign, I was the person that thought that there would be a number. A lot of women come out to try to sell their stories because Mr. Trump was well known as the most eligible bachelor and dated the most beautiful women. And it was clear that based on my past experience, that when someone is running for a public office like this, it's very common for these women to call up a magazine like the National Enquirer to try to sell their stories. Or I would hear it in the marketplace through other sources that stories are being marketed.
Did you have or express any ideas about how you may be able to help kind of deal with those stories by women?
All I said was I would notify Michael Cohen.
What about Bill and Hillary Clinton? Did their names come up during this meeting?
Yes.
Can you explain how?
As I mentioned earlier, my having the National Enquirer, which is a weekly magazine, and you focus on the cover of the magazine and who and what is the story that's the topic of the week. The Hillary running for president and Bill Clinton's womanizing was the biggest, one of the biggest sales I had for the National Enquirer and the other tabloids. That's the other things that the readers wanted to read about, and that's what I would sell weekly. So, I was running the Hillary Clinton stories. I was running Hillary as an enabler for Bill Clinton with respect to all of the womanizing. And it was easy for me to say that I'm going to continue running those types of stories for the National Enquirer.
And did you believe that that would help Mr. Trump's campaign?
I think it was a mutual benefit. It would help his campaign. It would also help me.
Here to share their expert analysis, CNN senior legal analyst and former state and federal prosecutor Ellie Honig, Elise Adamson, also a former federal prosecutor, and CNN legal commentator and former Trump attorney Tim Parlatore. So obviously, they're trying to get the establishment that David Pecker was the eyes and ears of this catch-and-kill scheme. Was this a useful amount of or productive use of their time?
Absolutely. This is chapter one in this whole story. This is really where the whole story that leads up to the payments to Stormy Daniels starts. Now, it's August 2015. Donald Trump has just come down the escalator a couple months prior to announce his presidential campaign, and he has this meeting with Michael Cohen and with David Pecker and maybe with Hope Hicks. That becomes a source of contention later in the trial, where they have this explicit meeting. We are going to work together. We're going to try to put out damaging stories against others. We're going to try to protect you, Donald Trump, against stories that could hurt you. And we're going to do whatever we can to protect your presidential campaign. So it all springs off this. I should say the Hope Hicks issue becomes a little bit unclear because Pecker says she's there in or out. Cohen doesn't remember. Hope Hicks herself doesn't remember. Minor detail, but that's the core of this.
I mean, the idea of a catch and kill is not inherently illegal. I mean, you can obviously contract with someone in different stages of their life and say, I'd like to buy your story, your life rights, or otherwise, and it not be a violation. Did they bring it home to suggest as to why this would be essential in building a criminal case, though, against Donald Trump?
I think it is, you know, part of the whole background of leading up to the Stormy Daniels payment. However, yeah, my personal opinion is that they went a little bit too far with this as far as the level of detail, particularly in light of the appellate court decision in Harvey Weinstein's case about all these other bad acts.
That case, of course, explaining that you have to be very careful about the number of prior bad acts or uncharged conduct that you are using to show that this person has an MO to do this very thing.
Exactly. Because ultimately what we have here is something the prosecutor described as a conspiracy to influence the outcome of an election. But the thing is, a conspiracy to influence the outcome of an election is not a crime. In fact, it's the dictionary definition of a campaign. People getting together to try and influence how people vote.
That was exactly the opening statement of the defense counsel.
Right. And, you know, to bring it across the line from something that's a legal campaign to an illegal, you know, crime, you have to have something more than that. And I think that while they're trying to set the stage, and they did a very good job of showing how dirty campaigns are, showing how dishonest certain segments of the media may be, and really kind of the dirtiness of this whole thing, I think it went a little bit far afield from what they were supposed to really be proving here, which is false business records.
Elise, I want to hear from you on this because, yes, this is part of the media, that aspect of the media's industry. They're talking about the catch and kill, but he has been charged with 34 counts of falsified business records. Is this the way to have made the first impression with this jury? He was on the stand for hours.
Yeah, I think so, because this was, as we've already said, this was the beginning of that narrative. This was the conspiracy, and it also explained why he did it. This was during the election season. We were very close to the election. He needed these stories buried because he wanted to win. That is a really key detail for me, because the counter narrative is no. This wasn't because of the election. He was embarrassed. He didn't want his family to find out about these affairs. So this wasn't going to be a campaign contribution, which is also going to what the illegality was here. This was just a man paying to protect his family. That's not true. And I think we needed this testimony to establish it was a conspiracy to influence the election.
This was a period of 4 days with this witness, 10 hours total on the stand. So at this point in the trial, they have established the so-called catch and kill agreement between David Pecker, his publications, and Donald Trump. The scheme called for David Pecker to purchase Karen McDougal's story about her alleged affair with Donald Trump in order to keep it from becoming public. The plan, as Pecker tells it, called for his company to then transfer those rights to a company Michael Cohen created in exchange for the money paid to catch and kill the story. In this next section from the court transcript, Pecker testifies about how and why he called off that agreement.
Did you discuss with Michael Cohen the matter of where the money to reimburse you, where this $125,000 was going to be coming from?
I assumed it was coming. I shouldn't say that. I assumed he was being reimbursed. He was always being reimbursed.
By whom?
By the Trump Organization, or Donald Trump.
Okay. I am showing you People's 162 in evidence. Do you recognize this?
Yes.
What is it?
This is an assignment from American media to Resolution Consultants assigning the rights to the Karen McDougal story.
Are you familiar with the terms assigner and assignee?
Yes.
Can you explain to the jury what those terms mean, and who was the assigner and the assignee?
Well, the assigner, American Media, owns the rights to the Karen McDougal story and has the right to decide to assign it to anyone that they wanted to. And the assignee is the person who is receiving them. So all of the rights that American Media had are being passed on to Resolution Consultants.
Who signed on the behalf of the assigner, AMI?
That's my signature.
And you were the CEO?
And I am CEO.
And who signed on behalf of the assignee? Do you recognize that signature?
That is Michael Cohen.
And what was the date of the assignment of rights?
The 30th day, September 30th.
And is that the last day of AMI's fiscal quarter?
Yes.
Did you agree upon a price that Resolution Consultants would pay for the rights?
Yes, $125,000.
Now, even though this agreement was signed, was it ever actually executed?
No, it wasn't.
Now, again, I'm going to ask you to be very careful here. Without revealing any privileged conversations with your legal counsels or general counsel, did you have a conversation with your general counsel?
I did.
And based on that conversation, did you come to the decision that you no longer wanted to be reimbursed for the money that AMI had laid out to acquire Ms. McDougal's lifetime rights?
Yes, that's correct.
Did you communicate that decision to Michael Cohen?
Yes.
Do you know about when it was that you communicated that decision?
It was the first week of October.
Of 2016?
It was the first week of October of 2016.
Tell us about that conversation.
Yes, I called Michael Cohen and I said to him that the agreement, the assignment deal is off. I'm not going forward. It's a bad idea, and I want you to rip up the agreement. He was very, very angry, very upset, screaming basically at me. And I said, I'm not going forward with this agreement. Rip it up. And he said, excuse me, Michael Cohen said, the boss is going to be very angry at you. I said, I'm sorry, I'm not going forward. The deal is off. And he said, I can't believe it. I am a lawyer. I'm your friend. I don't understand why you're so concerned. I said, I'm very concerned. I'm not going forward, period. And I said, are you going to rip it up or not? And he said, I'll take care of it.
To be clear, Mr. Pecker, did AMI ever get reimbursed for the money?
No.
Let me finish the question. Did AMI ever get reimbursed for the money it spent to acquire the exclusive rights to Ms. McDougal's story about her affair with Mr. Trump?
No, we never did.
So a very important point here that's been raised about Karen McDougal, this is not the underlying conduct that's being charged at the Stormy Daniels payment. This is part of that pattern of prior conduct to establish the catch and kill scheme that has been used. But the idea of the falsified business records and the reimbursement of payment is at the core of this particular case. Ellie, when you look at this, Pecker was never reimbursed the money that was used to repay Karen McDougal or, of course, a doorman in the Trump Tower as well. Why is that so significant?
This is the last straw for David Pecker and AMI, his company, the National Enquirer, because the first two deals, they were supposed to have paid for somehow in conjunction with Michael Cohen and Donald Trump. Both times, they, meaning David Pecker and AMI, they got stiff. They got stood up. You see him describing right here. He's having these conversations with Cohen, and he realizes he's not going to get paid. And what that does is it sets the stage for what comes next, which is Stormy Daniels. And that's what's charged in this case. And what happens there is early on, David Pecker and AMI are involved in trying to buy the Stormy Daniels rights. But then David Pecker and AMI say, we're out. We're out of here. We're tired of getting stiffed. Our lawyers are telling us this might be a little shady. So it sets the stage for really the most important transaction.
The lawyer part about it maybe being shady about campaign finance, we learned as well that there was a consultation with an election lawyer at some point in time. Again, this goes to the heart of the matter because, remember, this is about falsified business records. If it were just a misdemeanor, that would be enough to talk about a falsified business record as your potential burden of proof. But as a felony, as you know, Elise, they had to actually cover up a different crime, which is when the campaign finance contribution comes into play. So the idea of consulting with the lawyer first and thinking this might not be on the up and up, that's revelatory.
That's right. I mean, because it wasn't on the up and up, that's why we're here right now and having this conversation. Now there has been criminal charges brought for the exact scheme that would have happened there, which is reimbursements for what the DA's office is alleging was an illegal campaign contribution. So yes, very significant there, and also interesting that Pecker at that point even raised it to the GC and realized that something might be off, and ultimately, I think, benefited from that advice.
You know, we actually didn't hear from Karen McDougal, and there is a long list of people that were called in this case by the prosecution. We didn't hear from her. Is that because this was too far in the left field in terms of not being quite in line with this case?
I think so. I mean, Karen McDougal was on their witness list. There was an expectation that she was going to be called. But the Harvey Weinstein decision actually came out within the first, you know, week or so of testimony, in the middle of David Pecker's testimony. And so when the appellate court kind of restricted how much you can get into these prior bad acts, I would assume that the district attorney's office at that point sat there and said, okay, maybe we need to shave pieces off, like Karen McDougal. And, you know, some of the first parts of David Pecker's story, that happened before the law changed. So I think that that may be what went into the calculus.
And remember, there is no burden of proof to prove that the alleged sexual encounters ever happened whatsoever. The core of this case is that they falsified business records because they believed a story would go public. Now, whether it was true or not, whether it actually hurt the campaign or his marital relationship is the very issue here. But, you know, in the long line of things, Ellie, the fact that we're hearing about this scheme, catch and kill, from David Pecker, this is not somebody who was charged with a crime. In fact, he got certain benefits, didn't he?
Yeah, he was given what we call a non-prosecution agreement, later turned into immunity, which means the prosecutors here, both the feds originally and now the Manhattan DA's office, made a decision, which we've made, all of us, at various times, and Tim is always asking for his clients.
I've asked for him.
His defense clients, which is basically, we think you have important and valuable information. You may be on the outer periphery of something sort of criminal-ish, and so a good defense lawyer like Tim is going to say, he'll talk, but you need to give him a free pass. And that was the decision that was made with Pecker, and I think fairly. I don't think he was ever really chargeable with anything, but I also think they needed his information.
And, of course, his information and how the jury will actually view it is going to be the most important aspect. He was the lead off. He was somebody they spent hours in the stand with. He laid the foundation for the catch and kill, which came to be a very important part of the overall trial. In this next section, you will hear David Pecker, the former CEO of American Media, Inc., under cross-examination by Donald Trump's attorney, Emil Beauvais. Pecker testifies that catch and kill agreements were fairly standard and that he and his magazines, including the National Enquirer, had deals like this in place with many politicians and also other celebrities, ranging from Tiger Woods to Ari and Rahm Emanuel to, as you're about to hear, Arnold Schwarzenegger.
And you testify today about having done something similar for Arnold Schwarzenegger, correct?
I did.
Around the time that he was running for the governor of California, right?
Yes.
That was in 2003?
Yes.
And in that period, were you trying to acquire AMI's holding into the fitness phase, right?
I did.
And I think you mentioned some of the publications Shape, Muscle and Fitness, Men's Fitness, Flex, correct?
That's correct.
And as you tried to make those acquisitions, it was a huge deal, right?
Yes.
Worth about $365 million?
That's correct.
And so you wanted this to go through very much, correct?
I did.
And I think you said it this morning, that you talked about it with Joe Weider?
Yes, I did.
Who is sort of a celebrity in the fitness phase and owns some of these publications.
Yes.
And Mr. Weider said, I'm interested, but we need Arnold's blessing, correct?
Yes.
And in order to move forward with this, would you call it a giant acquisition, $365 million?
Yes.
To move forward with this giant acquisition, you needed Arnold's blessing, correct?
Yes.
And so you went and met Arnold personally?
I did.
And you reached an agreement?
Yes, we did.
And there were a few aspects to this agreement, is that correct, at the time, right?
Yes.
And at the time of this agreement, he had not yet announced his candidacy to become the governor of California, right?
That's correct.
And so one aspect of the agreement was that Mr. Schwarzenegger did not want any more negative stories written about him in your magazines, right?
Yes.
And I think you said this morning that he had expressed some concerns with you that in the past the National Enquirer had run some pieces that he didn't like?
Yes.
And you agreed, did you not, to make that happen, to stop running negative stories about Arnold Schwarzenegger?
I did.
And Mr. Schwarzenegger also asked for help because he thought that there were a number of women that were going to come out and make accusations once he announced his campaign. Is that correct?
Yes.
And you agreed to help him with that, correct?
I did.
And in addition to that, Mr. Schwarzenegger was given equity in AMI, correct?
Yes.
How much equity was he given in AMI in 2003?
I remember it was less than 10%.
How much was that worth at the time?
It was probably worth at the time around $50 million.
$50 million in equity on a $365 million acquisition, right?
Well, it was equity of the whole company.
It's a significant amount relative to the size of the deal.
Yes.
And Mr. Schwarzenegger was also given executive positions, executive titles, at least in AMI's affiliates, right?
Yes.
And then he announced his candidacy, correct?
Yes.
And I think you said before that at that time, women started coming out of the woodwork, right?
That's correct.
And so this morning, you mentioned one story that you purchased for Arnold Schwarzenegger, correct?
Yes.
Purchased in 2003, right?
Yes.
But in fact, 30 or 40 women came to you, and AMI was following that, the announcement of his candidacy, correct?
Yes.
And you spent almost $1 million purchasing the rights to those stories, correct?
I didn't think it was that high.
Several hundred thousand?
It was hundreds of thousands of dollars.
And Mr. Schwarzenegger never paid you back for that, correct?
No, he did not.
Now, I think that the one story that you described purchasing this morning, was it the source of that was Gigi Goyette?
Yes.
And you bought the rights to a book that she wanted to publish about her relationship with Mr. Schwarzenegger, correct?
That's correct.
And you actually, during the candidacy, sent reporters to Miss Goyette to bring her to Hawaii to get her away from California so that Mr. Schwarzenegger could campaign, correct?
I did.
And at some point, there was some backlash over this, correct?
Yes.
And that happened when you were investigated about an SEC's disclosure relating to the equity interest granted to Mr. Schwarzenegger, right?
That's correct.
And I think you testified this morning that there was an investigation in California?
Yes.
There were no findings against AMI in connection with that investigation, correct?
No.
And as a result, there was also an internal investigation at AMI, correct?
Yes.
And I don't want to get into what you said to your attorneys or not, but as a result of that investigation, you and AMI decided to implement new policies and procedures around this type of issue with assisting a campaign like Mr. Schwarzenegger's, right?
Yes.
And you did that, right? You implemented policies and procedures.
We did.
And you followed them, correct?
I did.
Followed them, including in connection with the events you described in 2015, 2016, and 2017, correct?
I thought I did.
You thought you did?
Yes.
Okay, clearly they're trying to establish this is standard operating procedure, that this has happened before with candidates, that this particular organization has had some, he believed, a little bit of pie on his face in engaging in this behavior and worried about the disclosure of information. You have famous people like Mark Wahlberg, Ari Emanuel, and Rahm Emanuel, Ron Perlman. What point is the defense trying to make when he's trying to elicit testimony about this being the MO and quite standard? Why would that help Trump?
You know, there's a lot of really fascinating pieces about this piece of testimony. To show that this is something that they do for people, whether they are a candidate or not, and that it's basically handled the same way across that spectrum, what's particular to candidates is not so much, you know, I think what they're trying to suggest is it's not so much that they're trying to purchase the stories just to help the candidacy, so much as the stories come to them because of the candidacy. You know, there are 30 or 40 women that, you know, were not coming forward to talk about Arnold Schwarzenegger until he announced his candidacy. People, you know, Stormy Daniels and Karen McDougal were not coming forward to talk about Donald Trump until he announced his candidacy. And yet you have people like Tiger Woods and all these other people that were doing the catch and kill and purchasing stories when they weren't running for office, because that's when the stories happened to come forward.
So this helps them to suggest at least that, look, if the jury has to understand the motivation, to Tim's point, as to why there was a catch and kill or why there was a payment made, if it's not for the primary purpose of helping or a substantial purpose of helping the campaign, because in general, does that actually buttress the defense's arguments?
I mean, that's what the defense wants the jury to think, but the prosecution really needs to focus the jury, and I'm sure they will. That is not what happened here in this case. David Pecker testified very clearly that the catch and kill scheme in this case was to help influence the election, was to benefit the former president. That's why they did it here. So I understand why the defense has elicited all of this. Yes, it's industry standard for a tabloid. I mean, this checkbook journalism is not actually industry standard across all media. It is for the tabloids. But yes, it's been done in the past. That's great. But what hasn't been established is whether or not those contributions were later added in falsified records. That's why we're here. So it's different. They're trying to muddy the waters, but I think the prosecution is going to focus on the actual offense.
And yet, this witness can't give you the falsified business records aspect of it. He's not in the accounting department of the Trump Organization, doesn't know the ledgers, the invoices, or the checks written, and we know he doesn't take reimbursement, but he's still very significant nonetheless. In fact, the amount of money that's paid to, say, a Karen McDougal or Stormy Daniels, very different than what's been paid in the past, say, the equity contributions to Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Yeah, so first of all, not every witness in a trial gives the whole story. It's very rare that one witness gives the jury everything you need in order to convict. That's what you do as a prosecutor. You try to build your puzzle piece by piece. I think one of the key points they're driving at here in this cross-examination by Donald Trump's lawyers, what we just heard, there is an undertone of a defense here that this is a shakedown. And and I don't mean that term in terms of the legal elements of an extortion. I just mean in the everyday term of a shakedown. And it's relevant to two things.
Shakedown not by Pecker, but by people who are coming to Pecker.
Shakedown by the women, yes. The first thing they're trying to do is explain the timing. The prosecution will say, well, the alleged affair with Stormy Daniels, they would call it the actual affair, happened in 2006. Why is Trump paying her 10 years later, right before the election, because he's trying to protect against being hurt in the campaign? Trump's team is going to respond, no, he's paying her then because that's when she came forward with her hand out. The other broader defense here is, if this is a shakedown, if the jury thinks this is unfair, right, then it's not going to be a crime. It's not a campaign violation to pay somebody who's shaking you down. You're the victim of a crime in that instance. So this was an early theme of cross in the case. It kind of went away as the case progressed. I'll be interested to see if they bring it back during closing.
A really important point to think about this, and again, the credibility of each witness is going to be important no matter what part of the jigsaw puzzle they represent. But this particular witness still considers himself to be a friend of the former president, although they had not been in contact in quite some time. But now the question for the jury is going to be whether this witness was credible enough to establish that foundational aspect to move the needle for either the defense or to puncture something on behalf of the defense and the prosecution. So thank you to my panel, and thank you for watching Inside the Trump Trial. Be sure to check out our next episode. So we will dive into the testimonies of Hope Hicks, Stormy Daniels, and the star witness of the prosecution's case, aside from the documents, Michael Cohen.